2016. We'll start with our pledge of allegiance.
Pledge of allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Do we have any agenda adjustments?
No.
I'll need a motion for consideration minutes for April 27th.
We took turns tonight.
Okay.
Yeah. I'll make the motion.
Second. And do we have discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor? So I assume that there's going to be no public comment this evening for all administrators and resignations. Do we have any staff or student recognition this evening?
I do, Rose. And Stephanie and I had an extensive discussion when we get to our report, but I do have a few recognitions. First of all, last night we had our annual ice cream social, and it was absolutely incredible. I mean, you could not have wedged a parent in here with a shoehorn. It was so well attended, so positive. The teachers were serving ice cream to the kids with parents in the cafeteria. We had an art display going on in the gymnasium. The middle school were doing social studies projects and science projects. And in fourth and fifth had their, multi had their projects on display. And in the library, Mrs. Marquis and Amy Smith had a the book fair going on. And the library, she did not get out until after 9.
Wow.
And she made about $2,600 in one night.
Wow. Which is usually what I think they were saying they make in the whole thing.
It was great.
Yeah.
We were able to walk the hall and talk with parents. It was just such a positive night. It was just a great night. And I want to make recognition of that and thank all the teachers who were incredible, especially Sarah Williams, who organized the night. It was incredible. I also want to recognize our system improvement team. For the past few months, Mike's a part of it. We've been meeting and talking and discussing the school culture, which we've come up with some really positive things that impact our kids. And also, along with our system improvement team, our next meeting, we're going to be looking at goal setting for next year. And they've been great. It's been a great group to work with. They're very positive and just so forward thinking what we need to do for our school. And also, our teachers' meetings that we've had twice a month have been great. And also, Stephanie does the grade level meetings with the teachers, so we're up to date and informed on everything that's happening within our school. And the last one is our last meeting, we were talking about the statistics, and I had reported to Steve, and I know he's not here, I knew it wouldn't be. I didn't mention he had a meeting, but I just wanted to mention that he was concerned about the numbers that I'd reported to him. And I had emailed him this so he knows it, but in the 2012 census from the Department of Education, it placed the national average at 37% of reported harassment in a school. Ours is 8.8. So I want to make note of that and recognize the great things that go on for people who work with kids.
And oh, absolutely.
Thank you, Rose.
Anybody else on that? Presentations this evening, we'll move right on to superintendent's report.
We had a somewhat brief meeting with the council, a joint meeting. We discussed the library possibilities for extending APA through to the November election when they hope to have enough people to have a vote on whether the town wants to continue with the library services, and the board informally agreed that we would do our part and provide the space and the time as long as they funded the position, and we were not to do much more than, they used the term babysit, I would say a cursory review periodically by the administration. It was a good discussion. Glad to be able to cooperate with
you.
Can
I ask? Yes. Have you let Mr. Sullivan know that he can let Chris Watson know that she's going to run the summer program?
Yeah.
And let her know that she has $1,500 to take out her salary, and the rest is to be used for books for the summer reading program and any other materials that she needs. Because there was a question as to whether she could go ahead and start advertising and so forth.
Again, so the $1,500 is the culmination of her salary and what she can use?
She needs to determine how many weeks, how many days a week, and figure out what her salary would be out of that amount. But the remainder is to be used for books for the summer reading program, read alouds or whatever she wants to use them for, and then materials for projects and things like that that she might want to do with the kids.
And she might want to get with Sharon just to double check the figures on the salary.
But she can't spend any of that without a purchase order. That's going to be a formal vote, so any information we can hear ahead of time would be great.
Okay.
Thank you.
Well, what I've handed you is a summary of where we've been with the teacher and principal evaluation program. And really, I think you've given copies of both programs. Mm-hmm. And incredibly proud of the work that we've done on both. And the hours that were put into compiling this were incredible. And my thanks to Stephanie and the committee that helped us finalize the program itself. But just let me go through. I think it would help just to give you a review of the backtrack on where we came from it. See, it all started in accordance with the Meet Education statute. Each school needs to develop their own teacher effectiveness program for both the teachers and the principals. You need to evaluate performance and professional growth. And actually, 2 years ago, we started this. The committee that we formed at the time had the option of selecting one of four programs listed by the state that you could use. They're all research-based, and the state had put them forward. Through consensus and talking about it, and through our time at the RSU, we were familiar with the Danielson program. So that familiarity, and also, which I'll tell you, the standards that the state required, the Danielson program fit all of our needs. So we voted on consensus and went with the Danielson program. It was really imperative that the components be a part of it because in looking into it, you can't, it's like having a Cadillac engine and trying to put it like a Kia pod into it. It triggers downplay of what the other factors are, so it has to remain consistent. So the key components that the state required and that we had to make sure were part of the Danielson were 9 of them: standards for professional practice, multiple measures, a 4-level rating scale, information to guide improvement, a method to train the evaluator, the teacher, how to determine teacher of record, framework for observation, feedback, peer review, and plans for professional growth improvement. And all of this has to be gathered together, along with the observations, for a summative meeting between the teacher and the administrator prior to, I think it's like April. The other thing, too, is that any person would tell you when you're working with observation of the teacher, it should never be a surprise. Someone should know along the way what's going on, and you should have a cumulative record and be able to talk to them. So I put that in there. It should never be a surprise on how the teacher is performing. The one that we had a lot of questions when we met with the committee and to go over the program, but really the one that we really need to settle on is because of the new requirement is that the state mandates that the student measurement testing be part of this evaluation. So we talked about this and what we came up with, and I really think it makes sense, and this is everybody agreed to it, that within a classroom, 75% of your class should be attaining a grade of a average of 75% or better. And when you accomplish that, you'll get the 20% that goes into your evaluation, because your evaluation is broken up into, I think it's 5 parts, each one of them worth 20%. You can go through each one of the segments, but then the last one comes to the student measurement. And depending on how your class is done, have you met the goal of your entire class reaching 75%? Have they scored at a 75% or higher? You get all 20%. If not, you wouldn't get that percentage. And we all talked about that and agreed upon it. The de-enlistment program, what is it? It's a component of 4 things: expectation, goal setting, evidence, feedback, and growth, reflection, and rating, and plan for a pathway for teacher improvement. Summarily, the same thing we went over was with the Glenburn Principal Handbook. And now this one was developed by the NPA, and the components are primarily the same as what the Danielson has. It includes performance-based standards and process for professional growth, and it has 6 units to it. Process, and this is for me specifically, process for increased professional growth and learning, student growth and achievement, so held the same standard that the teachers are with student testing, school planning and progress, professional qualities and leadership, school culture, stakeholder support and engagement. And it does include a 4-level grading scale for self-reflection plan, which I'm doing right now. So we've been ahead of the curve. The state has said they keep saying it's a pilot year. This was a pilot year. Next year, they said it's a pilot year. However, we continue to work, Stephanie and I do with the teachers, at looking at it all. It's entirely new to us. The whole thing is new to us. I said the committee, we're trying to learn and go along as we have been. There's been a lot of questions that we've worked out together, but it worked out together very well. So the consensus was, the plan that I put for you before you tonight was agreed upon to move forward with.
And not the rush with it, but you know that the state has given a 3rd pilot year. They require you to still hand it in 30 days prior to the opening of schools. So that moves us back to May 31st. We have to have it in. With the idea that you've turned it in, but you can tweak it next year.
So the student testing, 75%, that seems to be aligning well with the new grading system that's in place. And
yes, and a lot of that, and it was a big thing in the push for standards mastery, is student growth, showing student growth. So where they are at the beginning of the year and intervals throughout the year. And that's not just here, that's, I think, where we stemmed from creating these assessments was starting with knowing that we would have to, I think it goes back to 2012 is when they started foreseeing this to be happening.
And how is the staff adjusting to it?
They're learning as we go along as well. There was the adjustment that we had to institute testing process for the specials for a matter of equity. It's just been a huge learning curve. We went in with the standards. We've gone from the numerical base into the 4-level grading. But as we learn about it, we're learning together. But they've been great.
So is there an opportunity, either during the small meetings that you have, group meetings, or as a whole, to have discussion about questions and where it is a learning process for everybody and determine, gee, that's a good question, how do we overcome that hurdle? How is that being handled?
We've been focusing mostly on the committee that we met with, we brought the questions to
for
us.
The grading system or for this?
Well, for this. Oh. I mean, this is going to affect the staff.
Right.
How is are they able to, you know, if it's a learning process together and it affects them directly, how, I mean, are the concerns coming up during grade level meetings or in meetings as a whole, where are they able to ask those questions and maybe offer their input for, gee, this, I'm really having a hard time with this, can you help me, whatever.
They have used, with the exception of, because the state kept giving us pilot years, with the exception of that student growth piece added in, so I guess 80% of it, with the exception of that, we have been using that for the evaluations for this year and last year. So it's been a learning curve. I would say this year has been a lot better for everybody involved than last year, where it was new. Grade level meeting, yes, they certainly can ask questions during that. The staff meetings that we have twice monthly, and also during the process, where if you look at the timeline, it lays out at the beginning of the year, we have a big meeting and explaining everything, the training of, and the retraining, but familiarizing the staff at the beginning of the year with the goal setting, always the opportunity to come in and talk about the process throughout, checking in with the goals, mid-year, with the evaluations. So there's a lot of time.
Yeah, and even more so with the people who were formally observed this year. We
have
pre-observation that we were able to go through the entire format with them. We would have a specific handout for these people. So probably more so for them that we had for the general teaching staff. But like Stephanie said, the opportunity has been there. Other than the, but be specific, we didn't have in-depth discussions as a group, but we did with a smaller group when we brought together. Because it really took us a lot of time just to get it together, because what we had to do is take the Danielson plan and make sure that it aligned with everything the state was asking from us. So we literally had to take a plan and Glenburnize it.
Right.
And it took time to do.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
As anything does as you're implementing it, it just might be good moving forward as you guys do your group meetings to make sure that, you know, there's not people out there that are feeling a little bit lost because it is a new process.
Yeah.
And you know, gee, I'm unclear about how to do this. And even if it's just, okay, you can't answer that question to them personally, but hey, what time can we get together and we'll sit down and go through it.
It strikes me that this is pretty interactive, and it also strikes me that there's less opportunity for somebody to say, well, you didn't evaluate me the same way you evaluated my colleague next door. It's never going to be exactly the same for every employee, just like you don't do exactly the same for your children. You do for the employee that needs this and something else for that employee. But at least it takes the mystery out of what does evaluation look like.
You know, the other thing, too, is that for years, I don't think it was to our school at all, but I know and talk with colleagues that people would say, I haven't seen. Mm-hmm. And that's just a huge thing to start off to make sure that someone's actually coming to your classroom observing what you're doing. Mm-hmm. And this year, I think, was it 88 between you and I?
Well, we started the last year, I guess, just trying to start this new process was huge.
Right.
We found that the ones that were not in a formal year didn't feel we got in enough. So we implemented the walkthroughs. So we made sure to get in so the informal walkthroughs at least twice a year with those other. And I think that really helped.
That worked well. I mean, you can informally walk through at any time, but it was nice to document that those two times were there, so we had.
So the walkthrough, we actually wrote a list. Just had a quick checkoff list of when you walk through, what'd you see, and put it on their desk, and just more communication.
Yeah.
And a goal setting, too. Even though if they're not in a formal year, they still have the goals, and we still meet in the fall, mid-year, to check in, and at the end to follow up, too.
It also allows for the opportunity. There was a concern, and we put in writing that even informally, someone could come in and say, hey, look, let's talk about this. Mm-hmm. So. And with it rotates too, because with the people who are on probation have three times a year, and then people who are formally who are continuing contract have twice, and then we have the two informal.
So probationary teachers are evaluated each year of their probationary period.
That's right.
Yeah.
Continuing contract teaches a 2-year rotation or
three-year rotation.
But then during that year that they're observed, they have to be formally observed twice. And another thing with feedback, at the end of the year with the goals, feedback that with a summative, more of a write-up, and that is something that the state model that they gave for schools to either adopt or to piece through and pick what ones maybe you were missing. But now with that one, it is a nice write-up at the end. So I think that will be a positive thing to add to. That's something we didn't do last year.
And it really, because of the magnitude and the intricacy of the whole program, you've got to get from the get-go, from from being in classrooms. You just, it's something that just can't be put off. You can't do that. You've got to be on it. We did.
That's good. That's good.
And it's 75% of all of the classes, subjects that a teacher teaches. It's not like 75% of my literacy grade. It's
no, so
a third
like
grade teacher,
K-5.
It's all the things she teaches.
Yes.
A middle school teacher, it's all the English classes
right.
that
and we
Jeff
did
Parker
read,
teaches as
we,
an example.
In an idea of equity, the specials teachers, we really point for accountability for them to be a part of everything. Now, as going through the laws, if you don't have them, it's the 80% of the time. They don't have to fall under that. They fall into a different category. So we've talked about sampling of those, so making it more manageable
right.
for them.
Right.
So we, the specials
yes.
talked this last, I think, the staff meeting. We
yeah.
gave them time. They came up with a plan, and we're going to try that in the fall to make it more manageable.
Just
more
because
safely.
Of huge numbers.
They have.
Well,
a
I
lot
remember
numbers.
The days where we used to pull kids that had special needs from art, music, and PE, and the art, music, and PE people were very unhappy because they believed that they were teaching a class just like the English teachers and the math teachers.
Mm-hmm.
And if that is accurate, which I believe it is, then they also have to have some sort of evaluative process
mm-hmm.
that looks at least similar to what the regular ed teachers are doing. So I think that that's...
I want to say PE even said, no, we'll keep the middle one, because we talked about the end, because they liked the, you know, the idea of throughout the year. So
well, that's the other thing.
Said,
everybody
please,
likes
can I
feedback
have that?
About how
yeah.
they're doing.
Yeah.
I did not.
No, I'm yours. I do.
We took a direct from
we took a direct.
The model.
There was no discussion.
Well, no, but I mean, it applies to you, but what model is being used for our other administrators?
I think it's, I think the way the law reads is that it's anybody involved in the instructional. We'd have to go back and look at the specific. I would assume administrators involved with students. That's my feeling.
Be the same.
That's what I think.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The same as the principal handbook, you're saying? Or the same as what?
I don't think.
Same as
the
handbook.
So, yes, the principal's handbook.
So you have to show how you plan to increase your professional growth. You have a piece of the action on student achievement.
Yes.
The administrators have to show how they're planning on the overall progress
yes.
and growth in the school.
Right.
Okay. But it's left to you to determine how you're going to demonstrate those things. Are you going to have a portfolio, which
oh,
is just
yes.
really
I think that's more of what that...
Yeah, okay. All right. I'm set. Thank you.
Anything
else? Yeah, I'm all set. Thank you, Russ.
Thank you.
Yes, Kim.
Sure. Okay. So this is the report from the Special Services Department. We've been busy holding 8th grade transition meetings to 9th grade. And we held our meetings with Orono and Herman last week. We did Bangor today. We have Hamden Friday, and we have Brewer next week. We'll be dealing with 8 different schools next year. If you add BAPS, Bangor Regional, and Stillwater Academy to that list. So we'll have kids placed at 8 different schools. So there'll be a lot of traveling. Tomorrow we have our CDS meetings. So our little ones tomorrow. And we only have 2 or 3 kids coming in right now. I'll keep you posted because sometimes we have families move in the summer, and that number might, you know, rise. But we're feeling pretty good about being able to serve those kids. We've looked at their IEPs and the incoming evaluations, and nothing, you know, out of the ordinary or surprising yet. We have local entitlement that's due a little bit earlier this year. The DOE moved up the deadline. It's usually in September, but now they want us getting that done a little bit earlier. So the due date for that is June 15th. Our allocation is a little less than last time, but I still think we can cover the projects that we have in there now.
And that's the money that we use to fund the speech, the OT, the PT, the psych evals, the professional development, the social work services. And then there's another project on transportation we might be able to create for special transportation when we have parents transporting for mileage and things like that. So I might add a new project to cover that. Sharon, Susie, and I need to meet and do the figures and figure out, you know, Sharon will help with how much we've spent in each project in the previous year and help me project what we'll put in each slot there. So we'll probably have that all done by June 15th and hand it in. The special ed child count and the 504 child count is there. There's a jump there in the 504, so it's a little bit higher. The out-of-district placement kids are the same. Nothing new on the horizon that I've heard about for next school year, but again, that can change sometimes. We're busy planning our extended school year program, and we've got about 30 kids identified. You know, we don't always get, you know, those numbers when they actually begin to attend, but we're arranging for that. We're calling parents. We'll arrange for transportation. I put the staffing on there that we talked about for the new budget, so the staffing has been reduced quite a bit. Monday, the DOE and the commissioner sent out some information that's going to be effective July 2017 on not being able to employ fully certified special ed teachers. They have to be fully certified, excuse me, in order for us to employ them. A lot of special ed teachers are hired on conditional certificates and provisional while they're working on getting fully certified. But this is a new requirement that's come out of the Every Student Succeeds Act, and the DOE and a lot of folks are worried about what this is going to do to school districts, particularly in rural areas that might not have fully certified special ed teachers or programs, regional day treatment programs, where they tend to hire folks that are kind of in the process of working on their certification. So there's going to be a lot of work going on and a lot of buzz. The Director of Special Services for the state of Maine, the MDOE, is already calling other states to see what they're doing with this requirement and how they're dealing with that. So I'm anticipating some pushback, but for right now, we have one teacher that's still not fully certified, and they basically told administrators to alert your teachers that they have until July 2017 to have all their courses done and be fully certified. So I've done that. And he's close, so. Contracts for related service providers that start July 1st for the new school year, we're working on that and securing a lot of the same people that we use, like Dr. Rogers and Dr. Misler and our OT and our PT people. The EdTech evaluations have all been completed, and Tom has reviewed them and signed off on them. The special ed teacher evals all completed, so all that's out of the way. June 30th, the state has us do an exit report for special ed, so that's just a report I'll go on and do that basically exits our seniors if they've graduated. And as of right now, I haven't heard that any of mine have not graduated. There's a couple on the line right now, and we've put some things in place to try to get them there because it's better to do that. To make them do another year. So we're working on a couple of kids that are on the line right now, but I think they'll make it. And then I also have to do what they call a summary of performance on each senior. That's like the last special ed paperwork in the file that kids get when we kind of graduate them. So I'm working on 9 or 10 of those reports on kids at the various high schools that are graduating. So busy May. Mm-hmm.
I may have missed it, but
yes.
When you were talking about the extended school year, and
yes.
You see those two numbers there, are those numbers confirmed? I know we talked budget time about finding a way to like have them sign something saying that they're going to attend. I don't know if we had time to get that in place or whatever, so I was just curious about if those are confirmed numbers.
They're not confirmed. Nope, they're identification numbers right now, so those are the kids that we've recommended ESY for. It's very hard to get the parents to promise that they'll be here mm-hmm. the entire duration because of summer vacations and family things. And I haven't had anyone sign like a promissory note or anything. Yeah. But as soon as we know how many kids for sure, you know, I'll report it to you. It won't be the 30.
Right.
But
yeah, that's why I was like, what?
Yeah. Yeah. So. We still have like a little bit of OT and speech. Mm-hmm. Those folks are around during that time. But we don't have anything firm yet. So as soon as I know for sure, we're going to start calling parents and trying to get the commitment. And sometimes they say, yes, you know, we'll send the kids. And mm-hmm. sometimes they come and sometimes they miss. So it's, but we have to offer it because it's special ed and these are the kids that we've identified that have, that would regress without the summer services. Okay. Are there any questions?
You using the Danielson model for your teacher evaluations
yes.
as well?
Yes.
So it's across all seven.
It's across the board.
Yes.
Cool.
Yeah.
Cool.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
I'll move on.
I would. Our whole thing.
You guys
are
together,
yep.
So I just want to make sure that we have any other
Mr. Worcester back there in the corner.
Yeah, well, I'm running the camera back here. As I reported last month, I was scheduled to attend two meetings, one have to do with web to school and one have to do with the new MLTI program equipment that will be coming next fall. Both meetings were quite productive. The web to school meeting in particular had some ramifications for us. The web-based interface for web to school, which we haven't used much here in the past, has been really fleshed out. It's going to allow our teachers to enter grades and other data through web to school through a web interface as opposed to having a piece of software installed on their machine, which will make management for web to school quite a bit more convenient. What we also determined at that meeting is that the standards-based assessment that had been missing from web to school up until this point has been integrated into the system at this point. So we are planning at this point to move ahead with integrating the standards-based reporting directly in web to school and not having to depend on a third party, which I think is a big win for us because we already have parents that are using the web portal for web to school already. The standards-based assessment will be one more thing we can add to that and have it all in one place. We're working on setting that up with web to school as we speak right now. And the process is going quite well. MLTI.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
Can a parent go on the web now and identify how that child is doing in English, let's say?
As long as the teacher is entering grades in web to school, yes, they can. It's all dependent on the teacher entering the data. And we do that at the
school.
Yeah, we do that at the middle school level currently. With the standards-based assessment, that will be pushed down into the lower grades. Currently, we do regular 0 to 100 reporting through the website. They can also access attendance information, and there's a lot of other information we could be pushing through that portal should we choose to, calendars and other things. But primarily what we use it for right now is attendance and traditional grade for the middle school.
Can I also ask another question?
Certainly.
So is that going to replace the need for jump rope?
Yes, it is.
Okay, so that, what did we have in the budget for that? It was a chunk.
Yeah.
We didn't?
No, that was covered out of a grant. That was covered out of her Title I, whatever it was.
And then I remember something about we'd already made a payment towards that.
Yeah, that was also grant money.
That was grant. Okay.
Yeah, that was. There's no impact to the...
It's lost grant money at this point.
Yeah, but there's no impact to the budget by making this change at this point. If there had been, we would have had to look at it a lot closer, but we felt it was the right change to make, so we made it.
And that was nothing that we could foresee.
No.
So even though we had a conversation about jump rope, teachers will be using web to school to report their
exclusively grade. They will be using web to school moving forward.
They're not being asked to use two different
ones. No.
And that was
a
big, with web to school announcing that they have mm-hmm. added this, I'm sure, because they're losing people.
Yeah.
Because they didn't.
Right. And when we talked to them several months ago, it wasn't It wasn't ready yet, evidently, because they didn't want to talk to us about it. But it's going to unify reporting and attendance and a lot of other things for us. It was the right decision to make, and as soon as we made it, we notified the staff that that's the direction we were going to go. And the only feedback that I've received on it has been positive. So
it wasn't, in a sense, wasted time in looking at the standards. It's still going to be graded in the same way.
Same standard, same number system.
So the idea of having to pull through your units and your lessons and pulling out those standards is the same idea. Mm-hmm. And it's not a completely new system that they have to learn.
I think so. As far as MLTI is concerned, I went up to Guilford and we met on that. We discussed the buyout in some detail. No really new information was presented other than kind of a refining of the timeline. They expect the new machines for staff and students to ship mid-July, or should arrive here rather mid-July. They will be picking up the old equipment between August 1st and 15th. And in order to meet those deadlines and to make sure our inventory is as complete as possible, we've implemented a couple of things toward the end of the school year. Student machines in grade 7 and 8 will not be going home past June 1st. They will be held here in the building from June 1st through the end of the school year so that we can inventory, clean, and track down missing chargers, things like that. And they'll still be using them in the building for normal classroom use, but they won't be taking them home after that date. Teacher devices, as I think we discussed at the last meeting, will have to come back so that I can send them back. To do that, I'm going to pull those at the end of the school year, because once they leave the building, I have no way to get those machines back. So the staff has been notified at the end of the last staff day, we'll be taking those machines back, and that impacts roughly 20 staff members. I've also told them as soon as I have the equipment in hand, the new equipment in hand, get it out of the box and slap a label on it, they can have the new equipment. So we'll make that turnaround as quickly as we can. But there's really nothing I can do other than what I've already done to make sure that we meet our commitments to the state. That's pretty much my report.
Do you want to share what you did to help us out in this, getting the conference phone?
Oh, yes.
Researching that for us?
Yes. Special Services approached me with a problem to solve. They've been doing more and more conference calls for IEPs, 504s, and whatnot, involving out-of-state placements and other things where it's difficult to get people together. And they had a concern that they didn't have proper conference phone equipment to make those calls on. So I approached Sierra Communications, who's our telecommunications provider. I went down to Bangor. They demoed a phone for me, reasonably priced for what it is. We have one on order, and it should be as soon as they have it. And they need to do a little bit of work here in the building to make sure our system's up to date enough to support it. But we'll have enhanced conference room support for Special Services after that time. So
that's important also, because we have sometimes parents at different locations, and right now they can't both call in. Only one can call in over our phone, and then we put them on speaker. So this will increase the participation in the meetings, and multiple people will be able to call in, which serves our parents a lot better to have that increased participation. So thanks, Ken.
You're welcome. Sure.
Yeah.
You want to talk about
We gave you several policies last month to review. They had some failed, either they weren't changed at all, but they were reviewed, or they had some minor language changes. And you can decide how you want to handle this. You can make a motion to accept all of them in one fell swoop, or we can do them individually. But the policies are EEA, Student Transportation Services, BBA, Glenburn School Board Members' Powers and Responsibilities, BCA, Glenburn School Board Member Code of Ethics, and JICK, Bullying and Cyberbullying. And we have not met otherwise, so this is the only order of business for tonight from policy.
So we'll need a motion. Can I motion to go through them separately, please?
Okay. Student EEA, Student Transportation Services. The only change was to add a high school bus run clause, which is on the second page at the top. High school bus runs will be determined by ridership and budgeting limitations. Otherwise, it's exactly the way it was.
This particular one, I know that we've had some discussion in transportation on that half mile. So I think that this one, I would ask that we table it until next meeting, only because I think there might be some discussion on that. If we approve it now, we're going to have to go back to the drawing board again. I'm thinking on it.
Is that so acceptable to you?
It is. We could just table this particular one until Steve is here and we can have that discussion.
Okay. BBA, Glenburn School Board Members' Powers and Responsibilities. BCA, Glenburn School Board Member Code of Ethics.
So I move to
accept it or discuss it?
Accept.
Accept, okay.
Any discussion? I'm new to this role. Be patient with me.
All those in favor? I'm just making the motions on this.
And two accepted and one abstention. Alrighty. VCA.
Did you abstain on that one? Mm-hmm. Did you get that? That was an agree to one abstention.
We did that.
2-1?
Yes. And the last one is JICK, Bullying and Cyberbullying, and the change to this one was to add in the language about cyberbullying. Mm-hmm.
Move to accept.
Any discussion? All in favor?
That was all accepted.
Yep.
Now, could I please ask for summation of that action? I've got BBA, BCA, JICK, and we're tabling.
We're tabling.
EFA.
Yes, that's the transportation.
And well, it covers it, all right. Except for the JFA.
JFA, where you at with JFA?
I think that my recommendation is to wait on that until we get back from our attorneys.
I do not have that.
No, we do not. That was not one of the list of things to be discussed.
All right. And we'll move right along.
The only hitch I would say is if we hear back within 2-3 days, I would like, if we can clean up whatever little things that there are, I'd like to be able to issue those soon.
We can't can't issue them until they're approved.
No, I understand that, so that's what I'm asking.
I guess I didn't realize that we had such an issue with this, where it had to go back before an attorney.
Finally get it done to submit to them. That was a problem.
I know, but I thought we were working off one that was already vetted.
We did, and I put that in the language when I sent to the attorney, that I showed it to Sharon, that we didn't want any deep research, because they already did the research, submitted it to staff 63. And I got the response back yesterday, was it this morning? I guess this morning. That there are some changes that need to be made, and there's some little stuff, but, and I guess that comes from copying the first draft from RSU 63. Somewhere along the line, there were some things that might have been changed. I don't know.
Okay.
But I don't want to be caught up in a legal battle if we don't have
Oh, I'll be honest with you. I am really frustrated by this. This has come before the board twice now.
I know.
And we're now in the process of trying to do kindergarten registration, and this question surfaces at this point in time. I don't understand why it wasn't brought up at least a month ago, possibly as long ago as 2 months ago.
Well, you want to approve it? Go ahead.
Well, obviously we can if there's an issue there, Doug.
I don't know what the issues are. That's the problem. I mean,
yes, we understand that's the issue. So there we
and we couldn't send something to the attorney until we had it refined from the process that we went through. Pretty much.
Okay. We have not had a joint professional discussion meeting, but we do have one set for
June 1st, 3:00. And Mike is going to solicit from the staff topics that they would like to discuss.
Okay.
Is it possible, Madam Chairperson, that we could call a special meeting as soon as I find out?
We can certainly try to get that
together. I'd really like to do that.
We can put that together as soon as we can get some information. As soon as we have the information.
As soon as we have the information, we need to have a policy meeting to straighten out what needs to be changed, if anything. And then a special board meeting to get it approved.
We met this morning for the last time, and I apologize that I've not had time to type up an agenda, but I'll just run through it really quickly. It's a pretty short one, being at the end of the year here. Lori Springer updated us on the grant. She's not thinking that we actually got it as of last month. We were really hopeful because they called and asked for more questions, but and the first time she checked the website, it was something like 200 and something or 300 and something applicants, and there were like 400 grants they were going to give out. And she checked sometime this week, and it was 653. So she hasn't heard anything, so she's thinking we probably did not get that. But we're hopeful for next year, and she has some contacts that she's going to reach out to and see how we could possibly do it differently to succeed. She mentioned this when she first was applying for it, was that they really take into consideration the reduced lunch rate, and ours is lower than other area schools, and so that's probably played into it, but that's a positive and a negative. Heidi also mentioned that the food play came on May 4th, and it was a big hit. She thought maybe not so engaging for the fifth grade, because they were like, oh, so over this, but the rest of them were really engaged and went back to the classroom and were talking to each other about their snacks and reading their labels at lunch, and so it does have an impact, and the teachers all had positive input for her, so that was great. ACES Day was on Thursday, May 12th, and believe it or not, we had beautiful weather that day. All the classes except three in the school participated, and as far as ACES go, in case you don't know, it's all children exercising simultaneously day, and it's a worldwide event. We had all classes except for three. I guess two of them went out, but just sat on the grass. But that was a great turnout. And on that day, she had kindergarten and first grade. They were doing a nature trail scavenger hunt that Heidi made out of egg cartons. And she had pictures on it, and we had to go find it. It was an awesome idea, as Heidi usually has. Second and third grade went on a scavenger hunt of their own, and I guess the highest one got 24 items. Fourth grade played six-goal soccer. Fifth and sixth grade played a game called Swiper that's kind of like capture the flag. And then the middle school classes that participated played Capture the Flag and had a great time. So that was great. I was lucky that we had good weather since May has been touch and go. The school grounds cleanup, they had talked about that at the last wellness meeting that I couldn't make it to. Heidi started it with Mrs. Stahl's class. They went out and collected trash first, and she wasn't anticipating to find as much as they did. But that has also been really successful because I guess kids at recess have been doing it on their own, and so that's having an impact. They're looking at something to do with refreshing flower gardens, but Heidi needs to talk to Sharon about something to do with the funding and something about money we got back from the ski rentals or something. I don't know. So she's going to talk to you about that. The weight loss challenge ends on May 27th. They've had 27 participants, and so far the tracked weight loss has been 123 pounds combined. Field day is still set for the 10th, given the weather. It's a superhero theme. Heidi's looking still for more donations of the quick fill water balloons, the ones that come in those giant packs. The food form application for the teachers to have food in the classrooms, we were talking about a way to make that more, I don't want to use the word fair, but to make it, you know, universal, so everybody, it's not somebody's getting approved for something, somebody is not. So we're talking about ways to do that. We also decided that the teachers will submit a request to Lori Springer, and if it's not before our next wellness meeting, then she'll send out one of those Google vote emails, and we'll participate in the vote that way if we can't meet in person to vote on it. We're talking about discussing the amount of calories and the whether it's a healthy food or not, and making decisions that way.
So on the food form, what is the concern? Because I know that it was, when we did the policy, I guess, is it two per year that they get?
Three parties per year. She doesn't want to be the one that has to be the naysayer. Because it's kind of difficult for her to be the only one the school decides on, yes or no. So she wanted to bring it to a formal committee vote that's inclusive of more people.
As far as you were talking about, they have the three food approved days a year.
Right.
And then these are the extra ones where you might be using, for instance, Miss Porter just finished something with Harry Potter and wanted to do these snacks that were broomsticks that were pretzels with cheese sticks on the end, like a broom. Go along with the theme.
Okay.
So that kind of thing needs prior approval
now.
And so we were talking about a way to make that more universal and not like
a list maybe of something, and this is what you can do. And
no,
it goes upon their suggestions, and then we evaluate the validity of it and the health repercussions and that kind of thing.
Okay. Do a vote.
Got it. And we participate in a vote.
Gotcha. Okay.
And previously, Tammy and I had voted on that. The Lord just felt it was just too much to, you know, because I have a number of things that I had to do. I just look at how you feel. Mm-hmm. She said, do you mind if I watch this committee? I said, absolutely, go ahead.
I just wanted to make sure that there was, because I remember creating the policy, and
mm-hmm.
Just didn't remember if there was.
This is for outside of those.
Okay, good.
And then, let's see. Lori Springer also talked about, she had done the snack challenge with the third grade, and Miss Porter's fourth grade heard about it and wanted to participate. But where it's the end of the school year, they don't have 3 weeks to do it consecutively without being interrupted. So they're going to do it for 1 week. But it's neat that they were excited about that and wanted her to come in too. And then we were just talking about ideas for next year. There's something about a possible doing a garden. And I know Heidi had talked to Jeff about the possibility of doing that. That's just at the beginning stages. So that's what we talked about today.
Angie, could you send me a copy of all that?
Sure, I will. I usually send it right to Sharon. Do you want me to send it to you?
Yeah, send it to Sharon.
Okay.
Mr. Worcester?
No meeting was held last month.
Okay. We did have a transportation meeting and discuss actually the half mile. And I know that Doug's done a little research on that, and at this point it wouldn't cost us any money to add the students that are within that half mile radius, but I think it needs to go back over to have another discussion with the transportation committee to have a formal recommendation come through the board. So that was the, you know, really what we looked at. Talked a little bit about when the contract was coming up, but it wasn't really
much more than that. So we will have another meeting of the Transportation Committee and then put a formal recommendation over to the policy or the board itself as to what we need to do with that. And that's my big transportation report. Okay, building committee has not met. And high school subcommittee.
We also have not met this month.
Okay, so.
This has been a short distance between the last meeting and this one.
Yes. All right, old business and non-new business. So teacher and principal evaluation plan that they've discussed with us already. We need board approval on that, so I need a motion to accept.
I make the motion that we accept the evaluation plans for both teachers and the principals.
Do you want a second?
I'll second.
Okay. And do we have discussion? All those in favor?
I'm going to abstain from this one.
Abstain? Yep. Andrew's going to abstain on that one.
What?
Andrew's abstaining on that?
Oh, really? Okay.
Only because I haven't had time to formally review it, not because I disagree.
Well, if you disagree, you just raise your hand up. That's fine. All right. So moving on. Memorandum of understanding between the Glenburn School Department and Town of Glenburn Rec Area. This is action required. It's an annual thing that we do. It's more of a review. I don't know if you have any, anybody has any questions on this, but I do need a motion. I'll start with a motion to accept the agreement.
Oh, I move to accept it.
Second.
Do we have discussion? All those in favor?
Okay, you're signing.
School board representative for the public library board. This was brought up as the town council, during the town council discussion under the ordinance, there is a need for a school board representative. I know that Mr. Rich is doing it for the public portion, and I know that there's some concern about maybe having a little bit more time to think on this, so I don't think there's any reason why we shouldn't be able to table it. And I do have a question going back to the council anyway. I know that reading the ordinance, it requires 9 members.
Yeah, that was the 1978 ordinance or whatever.
And if you're going to update the ordinance, if you're going to use the same ordinance, that's fine. But if you're not requiring the 9 members, you really have to, you know, I guess my question is there really a board member that needs to be present?
Mm-hmm.
And I think I want to pose that question. I mean, I don't have a problem if somebody wants to, obviously if somebody wants to take it on, that's fine. But if it's a, you know, we all have so many other subcommittees as well.
Yeah.
You know, I just, I want to make sure that if, is it something that is that we absolutely have to do? They don't have enough members.
Yeah. Well, we also saw in the ordinance that it had 3 for 3 years, 3 for 2 years,
yep.
3 for 1 year. So that obviously can't apply if you're only going to have.
Well, I get. Yeah.
Well, they're not saying that they don't want 9 people. They're struggling to get 5,
exactly.
So they've got a quorum.
Right. So as far as they would have to change that ordinance.
Well, I would think that if you have an ordinance that's back dated back that far, maybe you update the ordinance and then.
And then go forth.
I think they're just punting until November to find out what the vote is.
Yeah.
So let's table that until next time. And I would like to get a little bit more information from the council or the manager. Town manager. Okay. So we'll do that. Request for alternate expenditures, Mr. Smith.
Some time ago, I was approached by the Royal to see if we could get a small push mower, snow mower, because he's running out of people that can shovel.
Mm-hmm.
He's got 2 or 3 that have back problems, and in fact, it leaves just him and one other person. And So I said, at that time, we'll wait and we'll see at the end of the year, because it wasn't taken up with the budget process. I said, we'll look at it at that time. Well, unfortunately, he and me advised to anything he does. He didn't fill out a purchase order, however, in this case. And suddenly we had a $2,100 snowblower, which is commercial, and I understand that. So I told him my initial reaction was take it back, send it back, because we didn't budget for it, and I didn't want it on the warrant, and we were all the cuts we had to make. But then he came back to me and said he's getting $3,000 rebate for some portable vacuums that were battery-powered that don't work, so they're going to reimburse him, and he's going to get a couple of the electric ones that are much cheaper. So he wanted to know if he could apply that towards it, since he's still got the thing here in our premises. And I said, I don't know, but I want to take it before the board because I don't want to do it unilaterally. The other piece was to check with Sharon to see if we had the funds to do it. And if you can bear with me just a second, I'll dig up my sheet. I think I sent it to you. The answer is yes, we do have sufficient funds to purchase it. And I know how hard he works and how conscientious he is, and I know his concerns about workers' comp claims with people who can't shovel anymore. And this is around the entrances to the buildings where he can't get a blower in. I think, even though I'm frustrated with the way things took place, I think it's probably in our overall best interest to keep the thing and apply the reserves that we have.
So I guess my question is it, what, does it affect the bottom line in any way? Are we putting even one more penny into that area?
Not in that area. You mean in the maintenance account? Or?
Yes. I mean, you're talking about a rebate, you're talking about a snowblower and then a couple of vacuums. My concern is there any increase to that area?
Well, if you spend money obviously you're going to spend money to... You're going to get a rebate for one, you're going to get $3,000 for one, he's going to buy a couple smaller ones that will be less than that, and between that and some other savings he's got in his other maintenance accounts, he'd like to purchase this. We won't go over the budget, but does it cost extra money? Yeah, it costs more money than right now what we've scheduled, which means we'll have a little less carryover.
He's got $50 in his Apple account, and he's only going to spend $25. So he wants to take the money out of his Apple account and put it in his snowmobile.
How you're shuffling the lines. What I'm asking is that figure that we voted on, that is not...
It will not exceed.
It will not exceed
no. In
his lines whatsoever. It's just more of a shift to
moving
where he
lines.
Feels the need, more of a need.
Would you agree with that, Sharon?
Yes, you won't exceed the cost center.
That's my concern.
But my greater concern is, again, we're having a conversation about an employee going ahead and doing something without doing the proper paperwork.
Right.
And I don't care whether it's an employee signed up for a college course and didn't get the approval beforehand,
mm-hmm.
or Jeff bought a snowblower or whatever it is. It's mighty difficult to be certain that our budget is going to come out right at the end if employees are doing things on their own and then getting reimbursed after the fact. So if you folks as administrators could say to the staff loud and clear the next time somebody spends money that they have not had prior approval for, it's going to have to come out of their own pocket. That we're not going to pony up for things just because the paperwork is simple and easy if they do it.
Absolutely, and for the most part, it's done. But we do have
For the most, I would agree.
We have some situations. One is contractual, and I can make a case and take it forward if I wanted to. But I think in the long run, we're going to put some language in our new agreement, so to speak, that's going to take care of most of those things. It's kind of like what part of no don't you understand clause.
No. Well, no isn't said very often, particularly when the proper channels are used.
Well, nothing's going to be purchased off purchase, period. Even if it's needed.
motion on that, whether or not we're going to.
I'll make the motion to accept the.
And I second. Do we have further discussion? All those in favor? Before we go into executive session. Before we go into executive session, I want to see if there's any recommendations or requests from the board in the next meeting. Please feel free to email if something pops in your head. Public comment. And our next meeting date is established for June 22nd at 7 p.m. And that will be in the wait a minute. That's a Wednesday. We want to see if we could move it to Tuesdays for a few months to accommodate scheduling. Mm-hmm.
So it could go with the 21st instead?
It would be the 21st.
Oh, that's after 47 years, it's not big.
We're going to move the dates for a few months. For a few months to Tuesday. So it'll be Tuesday the 21st, and if the municipal building is not available, we'll set it this week. It's that simple.
June 21st at the new school building.
Is that going to be a hardship for you on that particular day? You can do it for me. Just checking. All right. PMO's regular board business, and we do need to go into executive session, so I need a motion to do so.
We have two choices. You can stay here, we can go, or you can. Someone will stay here.
We'll go. Make it easier.
Okay, thank you, Tom.
Now I'll need a motion to move into executive session.
Well, will you all be down the library?
Google my office.
Maybe it's going to be in your office.
It's just me and two language. I'm going to need you to move.
Yes. Skittles.
Title 1, NRSA 405, compensation of officials, appointees, employees. I move that we go into executive session.
Do I just have to say second, or do
I have to do a second?